Our next session, funnily enough, we have Alexander McCall Smith and Upamanyu Chatterjee in conversation with Nandini Krishnan.
I'm out for this session. So when I told people that I was going to be in conversation with these two wonderful writers, a lot of people said, oh great, I mean, you know, fantastic, they're both funny, they're both, I mean, we love their books. And then they said, wait a minute, what do they have in common? What are you going to talk about? They're such different writers. And then, so I thought about it in the weeks leading up to the session, and it struck me that they have a lot more in common than, you know, memorable one-liners. They have or have had jobs to which a sense of humor is intrinsic. You work with academicians and you work with the government. So I was thinking recently about how I could structure an entire stand-up comedy show just reading headlines from the newspaper. Like, for instance, the Jallikattu thing which has been consuming newsprint over the last few weeks about are we being cruel to the bulls or being cruel to the humans who can't ride the bulls. but seriously, to turn the attention back to this session, another thing that they do have in common is both their first novels were astounding successes, and they became very quickly became hugely popular and successful films, leading to a television series in Mr. McCall Smith's case. But the question that I had for both of you, and I'd like you to respond to it individually, is that your writing styles contain a kind of humor which is hard to translate onto the screen. So it's not just, it's not one-liners, it's not entirely in the dialogues. A lot of it is observational. A lot of it has to do with the sense of self-deprecating humor that the characters have. And this becomes very hard to translate onto the screen without seeming contrived, because you don't have a narrator. Ideally, who's saying this, I think this at the moment. So often a character has to say something which he or she's thinking to another character. So what were the challenges which came with having to convert your kind of writing into a screenplay?
Well, thank you very much. I didn't have that actual problem because I didn't write the screenplays. The interesting thing about, or one of the interesting things about having your books made into films is that they don't want anything to do with you. And so they appoint you a consultant. I'm sure you've been a consultant, Mr. Chatterjee. It's one of these things that one gets. And the point about being a consultant is that you have no role at all. And so you go along and you discover that all sorts of things have been done to your work. And the only thing to do is to accept it. You develop a sort of philosophical acceptance of the fact that generally speaking, although I must say I'm very fortunate in that this wasn't the case with me, but generally speaking, you have to accept that the film has nothing to do with the book. And once you've accepted that, then everything falls into place. Absolutely correctly. I have a friend who wrote a book set in Berlin, which, as you know, is right in the middle of Germany, a very, very long way from the sea. And when he saw the screenplay which Hollywood had produced of the first draft of his novel, the very first scene takes place at the harbor in Berlin. And so he said, but Berlin's in the middle of the great German plain. And the Hollywood people said, oh yeah, whatever, what next?
In Mr. Chatterjee's case, I think the director actually had quite the opposite to say. So you, if I'm not wrong, you wrote the screenplay with Dave Benegal.
English August, the film is a nice film. The book is much better though, that's...
but there's a problem with the mic.
With the mic? Yeah. No, it's it's a nice film. The book is better, but it was his first feature film, so it was a filmmaker making his first feature film based on a first book that took years to get published. So. Both the film and the book have long, convoluted histories behind them. All that is in the past. So it's just nice that, you know, both film and book have had such long lives.
But Dave Benegal, when he did an interview, I think for the 20th anniversary of English August, the film, said he was very keen to retain certain lines, and he said, but then Upamanyu just said, no, take this out, let's not do this, this won't work on screen. Is that true?
I can't remember. I know, I really can't remember this. We did write the screenplay together, and I do remember that between the actual screenplay and what finally was edited out, the huge difference. He kept chopping in things, this won't work. Apparently, he has he has some kind of theory that it's also incidentally a Hollywood theory that when you write a screenplay, there should be more white space on the page than black. You know, it's completely minimalist. Cut the dialogue, cut screen directions. He followed some of that, so all that bristling wit of that of the novel is lost. But still, as I said, it's a nice film.
May I just say, one, I don't know what your experience was, but I find that there's a very fundamental difference between the literary world and the world of films. These are two different universes in my limited experience. In that, generally speaking, with books, when you write a book and you speak to the publisher and they say, we're going to publish it, that happens. That doesn't seem to happen with films, where there's something called options. They take options, and that doesn't mean that they're going to make a film. You know, people naively assume that options get to lead to films, but they don't.
That's true. Yeah.
And then you have lunch with the producers every year, and they say, we're just about to begin. And you say, that's great. When shall we meet next year for lunch? And then you meet again. And so you have. So my advice is always sell the film rights to a restaurant. It's much simpler.
So before we move on from the films, I just wanted to ask you, you had an excellent cast. And you had an excellent director, Anthony Minghella, for the film. But with someone like Jill Scott and Lucian Imsamati, is that how you pronounce it? And Annika Noni Rose. Those were people who filled out characters who had faces in our heads already. And they must have had faces in your head. So when that mold is replaced by another person, how do you deal with it as the creator?
That's a very interesting question, Nandini. I actually, in my particular case, I went to visit the set in Botswana when they were making the number one ladies detective agency. And I met Jill Scott, who played Mara Matsui. It had been very difficult for Anthony Minghella, the director, to cast her. He'd been looking around, and they had a very, very big problem in finding the right person. Unfortunately, people thought I had some role in casting, and so whenever I went anywhere in the world, I was immediately approached by traditionally built African actresses who said, I'm Mara Matsui, look at me, I'm Mara Matsui. And it was very embarrassing because I had no role in casting. I was just a consultant, you see, in there. And anyway, they got Jill Scott right at the last moment. And Mara Matsui, as you know, is a traditionally built lady. She's a very substantial lady. And they, fortunately for them, initially they had to put pillows under her dress. But she was pregnant at the time of filming. And so she grew into the role. And normally producers would be horrified if the star's pregnant, you know, what are we going to do? But they thought this was great, so roll it on. And anyway, so she did it, and I think she did it extremely well. But I never in my mind have an idea of what the characters look like. I see their clothing and I hear their voice, but I don't actually see their faces. So when I met Jill Scott, people said to me, is that right? Is that the right person for Mara Matsui? I was able to say, well, yes, if that's what the film people want, that suited me, because I actually didn't have a vision of the actual face. I saw a smile and I heard a good, generous voice and traditionally built, but nothing beyond that.
And how about Rahul Bose? English August introduced him to the world and he's gone on to make a great international career for himself. But was he Agastya Sen to you?
Well, we are talking of something that happened over 20 years ago. So my memory is now a little hazy. So if I begin to make things up, you must forgive me. I do remember going with Dev to some horrible play in Bombay because he wanted me to see the performance of the lead actor, who was very, very bad. It was one of those NCPA things, you know, dark, no movement, no lights, nothing. But fortunately, you know, he was just so bad that it wasn't difficult to say, look, he'll never make it. I met Rahul Bose by now I can't remember, frankly, whether it was before or after he had already been selected. But he did a very good job. He had that kind of clean, lost look. That's exactly what we wanted. But I must add that one of the nice things about the film is that they all act very well. I was very apprehensive that he would get that claustrophobic world wrong, the world of the district, of a typical district in India, that he'd get the office wrong or he'd get the setup of a government meeting wrong, you know, and if you get those essentials wrong, then it's over. But he got all of that correct, and most of it was shot in Andhra Pradesh, and the then chief secretary of the state government, it was extremely helpful. So all that, you know, made a huge and important difference. But to answer your question, yeah, Rahul Bose was very good.
So now I'm going to move on to their books, which is what we are here to discuss. So I'm going to read a little passage from Alexander McCall Smith's Mara Mosve, the first book, The Number One Ladies Detective Agency. And I'm going to ask Mr. Chatterjee to respond to that. So this is what the passage says.
It's the wrong writer, you should...
No, this is the right writer. and you'll see why once I read it out. There was a commissioner down in Mafikeng over the border into South Africa, and he would come up the road and speak to the chiefs. He would say, you do this thing, you do that thing. And the chiefs all obeyed him because they knew that if they did not, he would have them deposed. But some of them were clever. And while the British said, you do this, they would say, yes, yes, sir, I will do that. And all the time, behind their backs, they did the other thing, or they just pretended to do something. So for many years, nothing at all happened. It was a good system of government, because most people want nothing to happen. That is the problem with governments these days. They want to do things all the time. They're always busy. They're always very busy thinking of what things they can do next. That is not what people want. People want to be left alone to look after their cattle. Would you agree that governments essentially get in the way?
No, this is a sort of heavy question. It's a nice, I'm afraid I haven't read it fully, but it's sort of true, it's sort of universally true it's like the Red Queen, you know, running twice as fast to stay in the same place. There's a lot of government activity that actually is fundamentally pointless. It's very true.
We've got a lot of bridges in Madras over the last 20 years, I think, so we don't even remember where the roads are now. We've got so many bridges that they've covered the roads over which they were supposed to be built. Both of you deal to some extent with a comedy of manners and satire. So I think one big challenge with comedy of manners is to keep the characters funny but lovable. So you can't make them caricatures to the degree that people cannot relate, but you do have to make them funny. And I think, I'm going to talk about Emma, the modern retelling. And Jane Austen, I think, escaped this trap by, she kind of divided her characters. So you had these ridiculous characters like, you know, Mrs. Bingley and the Bingley sisters and Mrs. Bennet and the younger Bennet sisters. And then you had the serious characters like Elizabeth and you had Mr. Bennet who was lovable. But in your case, what you've done is, despite Mr. Woodhouse being a hypochondriac who's obsessed with everything, with the air he breathes, you've made him absolutely lovable and you elicit the audience's empathy for him. How do you hit that note?
Well, yes, this was a rewriting of Jane Austen's Emma, which I did recently, which, of course, Jane Austen doesn't need rewriting, but nonetheless, I have done a new version of that. And Mr. Woodhouse is presented as being a very fussy character in the original. He's very concerned about drafts. He gets very anxious. I was modernizing this, so I had him concerned about viruses was his main issue to because it's a 21st century version of Emma. I think that you can you've got to actually remain in sympathy with your major characters. I think you can set somebody up to entertain people and to do amusing things, but you actually have to have a fundamental sympathy for them. Emma herself is a difficult case because Emma in the original, Jane Austen herself confessed that it was very difficult to actually handle Emma because she was so awful. She was such an unpleasant character in so many respects, always interfering in other people's lives. And yet, if you portrayed her as such, in the book, without any redeeming features, people just actually wouldn't want to spend time in her company. And I think that's the real issue with the readers actually want to be in the company of a character, and that if they're fundamentally out of sympathy with the character, then they won't actually stick to the book. So you know you can make a character amusing, but you would always have to keep just on the right side of likability. That, of course, how do you deal with villains there? How do you deal with a villain? That's a bit of a difficulty. I deal with the problems of villains by not having any. I don't.
One can't say the same of Mr. Chatterjee. He has very memorable villains who do all sorts of horrible things.
Not that I can think of, but.
Well, I mean, you have Anguli Mala, who
he's a lost soul. I mean, he's not a villain. I mean, he's a murderer. He's only a murderer.
Well, he's both the hero and the villain in some senses, I think. So that's a good way to deal with villains. You make them the heroes of the novel. So
it's like Macbeth. It's like Macbeth. You show it from his side. It's like Raskolnikov. Present the thing from his point of view. Any objection? You're going to read some. Why are you taking? It's not funny. Why are you taking the last burden? It's.
No, there is a funny part which okay. You probably. I mean, it was written a long time ago, so you probably don't remember. So I mean, I love this one character who's the father of the two. There are these two sons, and the father is quite annoyed with this one guy who's one of the sons who's married a Christian, and he never refers to her by her name Joyce. He constantly refers to her as either your wife or that Christian. I think this is one. When he's sort of holding forth about the daughter-in-law. He speaks about the Bible. He says, let me find where this begins. It's quite a long rant. Does Genesis have any of those male and female soulmates who don't hump? Unlikely. He revolves to confront her. Your Genesis is pretty ravening and queer, isn't it? You thwacked it on my head, hissing, red, pour over. Evolve your psyche. Its passions are most Asian. So I waded through it and was overpowered out and out by the hard porn and the way out dollops of fornication, harlotry, defloration, gangbang, buggery, pederasty, incest, and bestiality. Wow, who doesn't in the Bible? But its soul is not a bit Asian, I remember caviling to myself. We, the humans, I know, aren't like that in the least. So he goes on about how the Bible is not applicable to India and to Indians, and therefore Christians have no place in his family. And then his son says, if he saw Hindu Mahasabha, why does he know the Bible? And I mean, I love that line. So this is, again, it goes back to that question where all these characters have foibles. So there are times when they are completely ridiculous, but you always bring them back and you bring in lines like this to which all of us can relate. So is that something that comes naturally as you're writing, or is that something you actively work on?
You know, this is really, it's like an inquisition. You know, this was written again 20 years ago. And you know, frankly, if you liked that passage so much, then you should answer this question yourself. nothing comes naturally. I mean, it's you just have to work away at it. It's true that there is, again, you know, most of what I'm going to say is bullshit because I don't remember what I was thinking of when I wrote that passage. But there is a Hindu versus Christian thing in The Last Burden, but that's really because of a fundamental, you know, it's a parent who doesn't like the choice of wife, that's all, for his son. I mean, it's basically that. So he's, throughout the book, he's just dredging up issues of discord. I mean, what can I hold against her, etc. It's, none of this would have happened had the son had an arranged marriage. I suppose it's Hindu society on the cusp, but I'd prefer to think of them as just people, as people who've, you know, just people like you and me, who've just going through good times, bad times. I mean, it's certainly not a religious issue in any sense.
Right. So, but there is another issue which I wanted to raise with you, because it's very tricky when you're writing about being in government service and mocking a lot of what happens.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, sorry. I should add, you know, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I should also add that The Last Burden was the second book, and I've been told this 100 times that, you know, because English August was easy to read, it must have been easy to write. And that's not true. But, you know, I can say this till I turn blue in the face. No one believes me. And at the same time, The Last Burden is not an easy read at all, and has disappointed a lot of readers because they wanted the more difficult books to read like the first one. In effect, they wanted English August volumes 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. But, you know, the writer changes, grows older, grows more boring. So there it is. Sorry, I should have added this, because that's the reason why the other books change in tone, because, you know, the writer changes.
Well, I think people were also a little upset when they saw the next version of Agastya Sen, when from being this lovable guy, he changed quite a bit. And then I think you if I'm not wrong, you said something about him being, I've got it down somewhere, him being a morally loose man in a morally loose world is what you said about Agastya. So you did not allow the audience to dictate what they wanted you to write.
Did I say that? I can produce
evidence.
take your word for it. Yeah. Yeah. Well, no, you know, characters change too.
So what I was going to ask you earlier is, when you're in government service and you're writing about being in government service essentially, and you haven't shied away from quoting exact sums that fictional ministers, of course, but exact sums that they demand in order to transfer someone from one place back to another and so on. So is there any hack to avoid being punished for this? Like, do you make sure that your book is published the year the government changes so it plays into their propaganda?
You know, I can again, I'm going to, I've said this 100 times before, and but no one believes me when I say that, you know, English August is not about the about an out of place government servant at all. To my mind, it's a book about feeling out of place in your own country, about the two Indias, if you will, of being plucked out of one kind of India and being pushed into another, and feeling completely lost as a consequence. To me, that's what the book is about. But you know, one can't control reactions, certainly. One wouldn't want to. So when I hear that, oh, it's a quote-unquote rollicking satire on the bureaucracy, this is how, you know, government functions, etc. More or less, you know, they were complimentary reviews, so, you know, one just lets them be. But it's still a book about that lost central character. It's not about those deputy engineers and ministers. I mean, that's just fluff. I mean, you know, it's a book. Well, it was a book. Nothing happens in it. I mean, he sits in his room, he smokes pot, and he masturbates for 300 pages. Nothing happens. At the same time, you could take that same character and give him a drought in chapter one, a communal riot in chapter two, a flood in chapter three, a prime ministerial visit, chapter four. And you could have him, you know, at the end of it, become Mother Teresa. You could. It's just consciously nothing happens because that's the plot of the book. So it's about him. It's not really about the world he inhabits. But as I said, you know, one can't control people's reactions. So you just let that be.
No, I think it's just that a lot of people could relate to the idea of sitting in a room smoking pot and masturbating all day, especially at the time that the book came out. So, but now I'm going to turn to Mr. McCall Smith. So as I've been 25 years old for many, many years, so I'm going to speak from that perspective. Your characters, many of your characters seem to think of people in their 20s as, you know, we come across as a really crass, horrible lot who has no understanding of art, who listen to thump thump music, and who can't speak languages, and who drop so many H's that one has to look for them once one has left. So I was wondering, why are your characters so severe on young people? Or is that what we deserve?
Well, I don't know whether I agree with that. I certainly don't take those views myself. I think that you may find that some of my characters, or one or two of my characters, probably not very many, might have said something intolerant like that. But that's not necessarily the view of the author. I think that one has to be very, very clear that views expressed by characters don't necessarily express the author's views. And that's a very, very tricky point, because many authors do get attacked by people for what their characters say. I give you an example of it. Some years ago in one of the Scotland Street books, I had one of the characters talk about a small town in Scotland as being a very boring place indeed, where nothing happened. I mean, it's a sort of be a good place for one of your books, perhaps. And nothing happened. And this led to a real row. And I was reproached by the local newspaper that was absolutely outraged and accused me of holding those views. It was the character who said it. Now, that's really, and a local politician said I should be brought to that place to apologize publicly to the to the people, which of course would be something happening, which would have cheered them up considerably. But it was really very, very difficult. And I think that is a very, very important point. So if one of my characters has expressed the view that somebody in the age group to which you refer listened to thump thump music, that's not because I believe that people in that age group listen to thump thump music, although I believe they do. But that's not the point. I'm digging myself into a hole. You started the hole and I've dug myself further into it.
That's what we love to do at Litfest. We've got 1,200 people pinning you down.
But I don't take that view. You see, I do have a couple in the number one ladies detective agency books. I do have a couple of characters. They're the young men, the apprentices, and their heads are full of thoughts about girls, and they don't think very much about more serious matters. That's not to say that I don't think girls are serious matters. That's... Let's get that straight.
How deep is that hole now?
But I don't think it's fair to say that I represent characters in that way. Sometimes people say to me that I represent men in an unfortunate light, and I would also defend myself against that. I mean, some men come across as being feckless or whatever in the books, but I would hope that I have a range of opinions. Sorry, it's a very long answer to your simple question.
No, we do like long answers here, but... especially when it involves digging yourself into a deeper and deeper hole. So tomorrow the Hindu is probably going to say, I believe people listen to thump thump music, but I will deny it.
And I'll be asked to come and apologize again. And let me apologize in advance for anything that I've said. In fact, can I apologize for both of us, as you were saying, Ms. Chatterjee? We're terribly sorry. We didn't mean any of this.
But that brings me to the question of censorship. Nowadays, I increasingly see that with comic commentary, stand-up comedy often has a political function, but censorship is so prevalent now that, you know, one can be paraded in the newspaper front pages, and one can be literally attacked by hooligans for saying something to which they take offense. And since most of these hooligans are not particularly perceptive and don't understand satire, it's become an increasingly difficult time, and not just in India, though in India it's become quite horrible of late, but across the world. I mean, even Seth MacFarlane's conduct of the Academy Awards, and we know what his sense of humor is like, but then people said, oh, how he's offended women, and he's offended people, and he's offended animals, and I don't know what else, extraterrestrials. But do you think 2016, for instance, is an easier time or a more difficult time to write than when you first started out, in the context of how politically correct one is expected to be?
Would you like, or shall I start?
No.
No. I think it's undoubtedly it's more difficult to write in a humorous vein today than it used to be, and that is because of the precise phenomenon that you've just referred to, of excessive encouraged sensitivity and willingness to take offence at the drop of a hat. Now, obviously, I think one should be sensitive to people's feelings, and I wouldn't for a moment suggest that writers should write in a way which causes gratuitous insult or offence to people. But I think that we have to keep a sense of perspective, and we have to make it possible for writers to poke fun in various ways at people, because that is a very, very important aspect of free speech. And it's a very important aspect of the exchange of ideas and of life in a civic society, that people can laugh at the foibles of others. And if you restrict that to the point where nobody can say anything for fear of offending other people, then life becomes impossible. I mean, I had a book published last year or the year before called Fatty O'Leary's Dinner Party, and it was all about a very traditionally built American man who goes to Ireland and gets into all sorts of difficulties because he's very large. Now, that, you know, he gets stuck in the airline seat to begin with, and then he gets stuck in the bath once he arrives in Ireland, and so on. And people were really quite concerned about whether this would be regarded as acceptable. Now, I think, in fact, he emerges as the hero. He was a very sympathetic character, and the book was published, and most people were quite happy with the... But I think it just got by the skin of its teeth because of this And I feel that this particular excessive sensitivity to offence is like weed killer. It's killing ideas. It's killing literature. It's killing humour. Certainly, don't offend people unnecessarily. Don't be cruel to people. All of that, I think, most writers sign up to absolutely. But if we get to the point where we can't crack innocent jokes, then I think that's the end of humorous writing.
Would you agree with that? Would you say that lines must be drawn, or do you believe that there is no need for any line and people should be free to write what they want? And if, because there are, especially in India, there are scores of people who are waiting to take offense. And if they don't, I mean, if your book releases just after, let's say, Salman Rushdie has said something to piss off a group, then maybe you're safe. But if it's a dry period where no one has offended anyone else, then you're in danger.
That was a very sort of effective summing up of the importance of humor and free speech. I doubt whether I could add anything more. In India, in particular, people who take offense usually don't read. So there's nothing you can do. He hasn't read what you've written, but he's come with some boot polish to blacken your face. I mean, there's nothing you can do. That's the sign of the times, I guess. One should, I mean, it certainly doesn't mean that you should stop saying what you want to.
Right. And now I'm going to move on to the memories of welfare state for a bit. And I mean, I think I should probably contextualize the word memories for you in India. So, those of us in South India and people from Bengal, as Mr. Chatterjee is, when we go to the North, we find that when people say mammary, they don't really mean breasts. They mean memory. So I would often, when I first moved to Delhi, there'd be people who say, oh, you have a good mammary. And I'd be like, how do I react to this exactly? So was that playing on your mind when you came up with that title?
Absolutely, it was, absolutely. In fact, I'm so glad you've, because it's, in North India, they don't actually see the, to me it seems so obvious, and it even seems such a stupid title, but no one actually saw this, this obvious sort of terrible low-grade pun on memories, but it's really low-grade, but yeah, it's true, it's...
Well, it's hard to have sweet memories of the North Indians' pronunciation. I can crack the joke in Madras. I might get like ink thrown on my face and whatnot if I were to say the same thing in UP.
More Punjab, I think. More Delhi and Punjab than... it's a very Punjabi pronunciation.
Would they be memories. Able to... I mean, if I said that, would they... Was it all
no, memories? They, if you say memories, they presume you're saying memories.
Yeah. So they probably wouldn't realize they had to take offense at that particular point until maybe someone wrote about it and they'd say, oh, wait. Mr. McCall Smith, a lot of your characters seem to devour art. Thankfully, only one does so literally, the dog, Freddy De La Haye. And I was telling you a couple of days ago that he reminded me of my own dog, who eats his lunch bowl. And I know that when he has that guilty look, I know he's done something. It usually has to do with destroying something that I bought for him. And very often destroying something I bought for myself. So was there a real life inspiration for Freddy De La Haye?
The dog characters in two of my series, in the Scotland Street books and the Corduroy Mansions books to which you refer, I just introduced them initially as small part actors. They weren't central characters. So in the Scotland Street books, there's a dog called Cyril, who's the only dog in Scotland with a gold tooth. And this distinguishes him in that particular respect. And then in the Corduroy Mansions, there's this dog with this wonderful name, Freddy De La Haye. And I was surprised at the support that these dogs rapidly got, in that they very quickly became more popular than the human characters. And talking about this issue of how you must be careful in what you say. If you think it's difficult and tricky writing about human beings, try writing about dogs, and then you really find you give offense to dogs very, very quickly. And and I have all sorts of letters about these dogs. There, people write to me from all over the world about what is happening to Freddie Le LaHaye or Cyril. I had one scene in the Scotland Street novels where Cyril is kidnapped and he's taken off. And that led to, because these are serial novels published in the newspaper before the book comes out, so this is in real time, so to speak. And I had people writing to me saying, is Cyril all right? Is he getting enough to drink? Are they taking care? And so this is very, very, very sensitive. I also had a dog in my Portuguese Irregular Verbs series, my von Eagleveld books. I had one of those books is called The Finer Points of Sausage Dogs. And this deals, incidentally, with Dachshunds. And I had a Dachshund there who unfortunately loses three legs because of veterinary negligence. And he's only one remaining leg, but they make a sort of carriage for him with three wheels. And he uses his last remaining leg to paddle himself along, which works very well, except sometimes on hills when it doesn't work so well. And I had people really quite concerned about this, although it was fiction. They didn't like the idea that this Dachshund had lost three legs. And so I felt I almost had to put a disclaimer at the beginning of the book saying no real Dachshunds were harmed in the writing of this book. And so it's very, very interesting. Freddie Le LaHaye isn't based on anything. He was a heroic dog. He used to be a sniffer dog at London Airport in his first, before he came to live with one of the characters. And he was a victim, we're talking about political correctness, he was a victim of political correctness because they discovered that all the sniffer dogs at London Airport were male. And this, therefore, discriminated against female dogs. And so they sacked half of the dogs, sniffer dogs at London Airport. Bad move, because they reappointed female dogs to those roles, and then all the male dogs were only interested in the female dogs, and drugs flooded into the country as a result. As a result of that. So these dogs have quite a rich life, and they've gradually worked their way up the pecking order in the novels, and now they're central characters and very important, and I have to be very careful with them.
Well, I mean, you brought in gender, so I'm going to toss this to Mr. Chatterjee. So in Fairy Tales at 50, which is your latest book, there is a lot of gender fluidity. So you have certain characters who are women but who want to be men and who take all sorts of testosterone injections but who also want children. And then you have a couple of mothers who are mistaken for eunuchs. So I wanted to ask... This idea of gender fluidity, is it something that came to you when this 377 debate was going on?
Which debate?
The four-year-old debate over the recriminalization and the decriminalization and the re-recriminalization.
That distracts me. I've written a short story on the 377 issue, which. Is unpublishable. So finally, Open was nice enough to publish it over the new year. But no, Fairy Tales has nothing to do with 377. It's people with the stock characters of Indian folk fairy tale, you know, and then you fool around with some of those stock characters to see what you can come up with. Artha Narishwar suggests itself, obviously, but it's universal, the notion of, they found everywhere people with gender problems. It's not as though I shouldn't be saying this. It's not as though it's a serious book, and it's not as though it's a book that wants people to look at the issue of gender confusion seriously. Am I saying the wrong thing? Or should I?
No, you didn't say the wrong thing at all. I think non-serious books sometimes become the most thought-provoking
ones.
Yeah,
that's true. Yeah, so. Great. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, couldn't agree with you more. Humor is what makes the world go round. Yeah, absolutely.
I've been, there are people holding up these threatening signs, so I think we should move on to a short reading. So you have a short story from
after,
the ground.
After you, would you like to start with? Well,
I don't mind, whichever.
I've got this lovely, I do all your selections for you, I'm sorry, yes. But with 84 books, I think I'm probably better placed as a reader to select than you as a writer who's busy with those.
No, that's fine. We're here to do your bidding.
So, do you remember which one that's from? That's from Corduroy Mansions.
From somewhere in Corduroy Mansions. Yeah. I don't remember. Oh, yes, I vaguely remember this. I think I did write this, yes.
So, it's...
but I apologize in advance.
I think I should have written something and tried to pass it off as your writing. It would have got a great audience.
It would have done, yes. So shall I read this quickly? It won't take.
Yes, please.
It's not very long. It's only half page, so very quick. William had devised a good way of avoiding talking, if one wanted to do so, a way that prompted the taxi driver himself either to talk at great length, to deliver a monologue, in fact, or to become quite silent. This was to ask, at an early stage of the journey, what do you think of the government? It is well known that taxi drivers have a low opinion of governments, of any government, but almost without exception take a particularly dim view of their own government. This question tends, therefore, to offer them the maximum opportunity to express themselves in monologue, or alternatively, it gives them the impression that the fare is a secret sympathizer with the government and therefore not to be engaged in conversation. This technique of asking just the right question to inhibit further conversation was a useful one and was used by William in other social circumstances when small talk needed to be avoided. At cocktail parties, where one might quite reasonably simply wish to stand or sit and not be pestered by other guests seeking to make small talk, the use of a discreet lapel badge was sometimes to be recommended. This badge might state one's religious position in unequivocal terms and invite discussion of it. Thus, a small badge saying, "Please talk to me about salvation," usually had the effect of ensuring a peaceful time at any party, leaving one untroubled by other guests coming up to engage one in unwanted conversation. Similarly, a badge saying, "No longer infectious," could usually be calculated to ensure physical space, another commodity in short supply at the more popular cocktail parties.
Thank you so much. And yeah, so now for Mr. Chatterjee's short story.
The short story was published last year. It's called Othello Sucks. I shall read just about a page, I think, just so that I can give you a sense of, it's meant to be funny. Othello Sucks. This being at some moments a piece of nonfiction, at others a radio play, and at yet others a comic strip in prose, Father, one of its four principal dramatis personae, feels that the title is incomplete without a colon. Othello sucks, colon, and then an apposite phrase from Shakespeare's play. The radio play starts with younger daughter at dinner spitting out the title without looking up from reading her mobile phone. No one responds. Othello sucks does not even register with either mother or elder daughter. Chomp, chomp, slurp, slurp, gas. Father is in four minds. He does not want to be distracted from his khichdi with meatballs or his meditations on his indigestion or his plans on what to take in his tiffin tomorrow. Yet not to respond to a cry for help would be churlish. Younger daughter would then flounce back to her room and slam the door shut so hard on her family that it would once more bring down plaster from the ceiling. In a chain reaction, the trembling of the entire building would in turn trigger the frenzied barking of the three Great Danes in the apartment two floors above. Thus, Father, airily, well, who doesn't in this world? Prompting from younger daughter, a torrent. Well, if it's English, no one in class can follow it. You did wish that I would make her turn, sir. She can turn and yet go on and turn again. And she can weep, sir, weep. And she's obedient, as you say, obedient, very obedient. The lines sound like gobbledygook, so you read the notes and learn that turn also means pursue sexual encounters, and obedient also means sexually pliant. So then the lines make sense, but big deal, it simply isn't worth the effort. And the boys go around saying, miss, make me your obedient servant. You dig deep for all that meaning, and all you come up with is a potato, and I have a class test tomorrow on it, and I'll fail, and I won't get an excellence award this year. Noises off, of plaster falling, while mother, coldly, how competitive you've made them. And elder daughter, in a daze, as though remembering September 11, I had the Merchant of Venice. In not more than 500 words, explain which of the gold, silver, and lead caskets you find the most screamingly boring. Compared to that, a retarded black guy who sucks is a rock concert.
Thank you so much. I think we have time for maybe two questions. I have to say before that, though, people who are aware of Mr. Chatterjee's current profile, please do not ask him about petrol prices. On behalf of him, I will say that he will not answer. All right. So can I see a show of hands?
Could I go ahead?
Yes, please. Yeah.
This is a question to both the authors. Do you think humor is defined by the region that one is from, or by years of reading and, you know, one sense of humor develops with time, or one's sense of humor is fixed and varies marginally around a comfort zone?
That's a very interesting question. I think there are regional variations in humor which are culturally fixed. And determined in a sense. So I think that regional differences are very, very important. There are different sorts of humor, and some people look at the world in a way which precludes their seeing certain things funny, which other people find funny. So that I think is a given. As far as your point about the development of humor, I think that's very interesting. I think that probably as one goes through life, one's sense of humor does change a bit, because I think one's seen more of the human comedy, so to speak, as you've gone through, and I think that one may be inclined to find things more, well, so slightly funnier. I feel, I mean, I find the world more amusing as I go through it, as I go older. I find more entertains me, because I spot more human foibles. I don't know. That's my subjective approach.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I suppose. Where are you? I didn't. Where is the? Hello. This. I think humor is more. More culturally. More culture specific than non-humor. It would be more easily lost in translation. Even within India, for example, something that's funny in one language or one part of the country is just not funny in another. It's really what, as I said it before this afternoon, it's really what makes the world go round. I mean, if you lose humor, you lose your humanity. I mean, it's just crazy people who don't allow humor and comedy to flourish. I mean, does this answer your question? I mean, I'm not even sure it does.
It answers some questions, I'm sure. Yeah, so I saw the lady with the blue kurta at the back. Do you have the mic? Yes, please go ahead.
Well, just to Mr. Smith. So basically, one thing you said is, because more and more people take offense in what writers have to write, it's getting difficult for them to write. But isn't it like the writers have some responsibility in changing the way the society thinks? Like, there was one specific part of a book you said, I think, which drew more laughter from the guys in the hall than the girls, which was like 50% reservation for the women and women dogs. And because of that, the guys are getting distracted by the, male dogs are getting distracted by the female dogs. And that's why they are not working. Like, recently we know that there was a scientist who made a similar claim that if you induct women into labs, then there's a lot of relationship troubles which go on, women cry, and in the end, nothing happens. Like, science suffers. And there was a huge outrage because of that. And ultimately, basically what I'm saying is, if in our society such perceptions still exist, and if writers like you, in some way, it's maybe not you don't like direct it specifically to women as such, like work, like people like me who are gonna join the working force very soon. But then there are a lot of ways we find, there are certain things which we find difficult, like there are reservations.
I think we've got your question, so would you, I think what she wants to know is, by saying that dogs are attracted to female dogs, to use the politically correct word, I think, in heat, are you suggesting that men cannot deal with women in the workplace? Is that, have I misinterpreted your question? That's what I like to do.
No, I didn't mean that. I'm sorry if you thought that that was...
You apologized in advance, so...
I apologized in advance.
I mean, I certainly didn't mean that. I was talking about dogs there, and you know, dogs really, male dogs can be sexist. I've seen this, actually. And, you know, we've tried to reason with them. We've tried to, but it's really difficult.
We need a dog whisperer. So I know that we've had to wrap the session, but here's a hack to talk to writers. Buy their books, line up for autographs. Writers, I think the rate is number of books into 10 divided by number of total copies sold across the world. Do the math, buy that many books, and that's the number of minutes you get with either of them. Thank you very much.
Thank you.